Well, good evening. A very warm welcome. I hope you can hear me okay. Nice to see everyone who's joined us this evening. We continue our studies, Meeting the Master, looking at some of the people who met the Lord Jesus when he was here. I think this is a fascinating study. I'm enjoying it anyway. And it's wonderful to think of those who met the Lord when he was here and the lessons that we can learn too as we think about these meetings. Often the people who met the Lord Jesus are anonymous. Their names are not recorded. We just know a bit about them. But sometimes the names are recorded. I'm going to think tonight about a man whose name is recorded in the Bible, somebody who met the Lord Jesus, and his name is written there for us to know and to see, and his name is Jairus. And I want to read from the Gospel by Mark, Mark's Gospel, chapter 5. And we're going to read a few verses about this wonderful meeting when this man named Jairus met the Master. Mark chapter 5, and beginning to read at verse 21. Now when Jesus had crossed over again by boat to the other side, a great multitude gathered to him, and he was by the sea. And behold, one of the rulers of the synagogue came, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet and begged him earnestly, saying, My little daughter lies at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her, that she may be healed and she will live. So Jesus went with him, and a great multitude followed him and thronged him. Now, at this point, there's an interruption. Something happens in the story. We're not going to go into the details, but a woman comes along who touches the Lord Jesus. The Lord Jesus stops. He deals with her. He heals her. And so the progress home to Jairus's home is interrupted. And then eventually, verse 35, while the Lord Jesus was yet still speaking, some came from the ruler of the synagogue's house who said, Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further? As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said to the ruler of the synagogue, Do not be afraid, only believe. And he permitted no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. Then he came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue and saw a tumult and those who wept and wailed loudly. And when he came in, he said to them, Why make this commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping. And they ridiculed him. But when he'd put them all outside, he took the father and the mother of the child and those who were with him and entered in where the child was lying. And he took the child by the hand and said to her, Talitha kumai, which is translated, Little girl, I say to you, arise. Immediately the girl arose and walked, for she was 12 years of age, and they were overcome with great amazement. Well, might they be overcome with great amazement. Amen. Tonight, I want us to join a group of people on the eastern shores of the Sea of Galilee. And they're all gathered there, quite a big crowd. And they're all looking out intently over the surface of the sea. You might look around the crowd and you'll see there are all different types of people there from all different backgrounds and walks of life. And maybe there's a man there who seems to stand out as being different. He's dressed well and he looks dignified. And it's obvious that other people are giving him respect. And you're absolutely right. He's an important man. And his name is Jairus. The Bible tells us he was a ruler of the synagogue. He had an important position in the local community. He was a man that was looked up to, a man that was respected, a man that was honored. And here he is in this crowd. He's an important man. But that doesn't matter today. The only thing that matters today is this, that he is the father of a dying child. The Bible tells us that he has one child, and it's a girl. And she's 12 years old. And he's witnessed this girl falling ill. And he's watched as whatever disease it was has advanced and her condition is deteriorating. He sat by her bedside and watched the life draining out of his child. And perhaps I'm quite sure he's wished a thousand times that he could change places with her, that he could take the illness, that he could take the problem, that he could die and she could live. And he comes to the conclusion that her life is just draining away. And the Bible says at this very point, she is at the point of death. She is, naturally speaking, on her deathbed. And this man is in absolute despair. What can he do? And then he remembers that he's heard about Jesus. He's heard about this man who can heal the sick and who can raise the dead. And here he is, and in this crowd waiting, and they're waiting at the edge of the sea, and he's there in absolute desperation and despair. And then a shout goes out, he's coming. And someone has caught sight of this boat as it makes its way across from the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And the Lord Jesus and his disciples are returning. And as the boat comes in and comes nearer and comes closer, and eventually it crunches onto the shore of the bank. And there's Jairus running down first. And the Bible says that he falls down in front of the Lord Jesus, and he's pleading earnestly. Listen to what he says. He says, "My little daughter lies at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her, that she may be healed and she will live." Dear friends, here is a man in absolute desperation. There is no one else he can turn to. There is no one else that can help him. There is no doctor, there is no physician that can help at this point. The girl is hovering in that state between life and death. And there's only one person can help, as far as this man is concerned. And he believes it. He believes that if you come and lay your hands on her, she will be healed and she will live. And so there he is, lying in front of the Lord Jesus, absolutely desperate in his need. And the Bible says the Lord Jesus went with him. And we can see the procession. Here we are. We're joining the procession now. The Jairus is out ahead. He's hurrying to show the way and to go in front. And the crowd are following. The Lord Jesus is following. And the Bible says he's thronged with people. The crowd are all hustling round about him. There's a great bustle. There's a great stir. The whole crowd are swelling along with the Lord Jesus as he follows Jairus up the road back to his home. And then, of course, the interruption happens. Interruption happens. The Lord Jesus suddenly stands stock still. And of course, the crowd all bump into each other and they all stop as well. And the Lord looks around and says, "Who touched me?" And I'm not going to tell you the story about that because we'll keep that for another week. But there's another story there altogether. And this woman comes forward and she wants to be healed. And we can just imagine what is happening in Jairus' mind at this point. He is desperate to get home. He's desperate to get the Lord home. Every second counts, every moment counts. And here I can imagine him on the edge of the crowd, absolutely demented with impatience and anxiety that the Lord will come. And after what seems, it must have seemed like an eternity, after what seems like an eternity, eventually the Lord is sending the woman away. She has been healed. And Jairus is saying, at last he's free, at last he can come. And he's just turning to lead the way again. And suddenly he recognizes, coming down the road, a messenger from his house, one of his servants. And he can tell by the look that it's not good news. And he says, "Don't trouble the master any further. She's dead. She's dead." Dear friends, I can just see Jairus' world collapsing. I can just see him crumbling at that point. The waves of despair, the futility, the emptiness of life, everything just crashing into him at that point. All that he'd lived for, all that he'd longed for, the love, the light of his life has been extinguished. And I think the Bible says it's when the Lord Jesus heard that word. I think he takes one look at Jairus. And he comes across to him, in my imagination at least, and perhaps he places a hand on his shoulder and said, "Jairus, don't be afraid. Only believe." Dear friends, what the Lord is saying is this. There is nothing else you can do. There is nothing else you can do, but there is something you can do, and you can just put this case into my hands. This is not this idea of faith, dear friends. It's not some sort of just blind optimism that things are somehow going to work out all right. The Lord Jesus is really saying to Jairus, Jairus, the only thing you can do at this point is just entrust the whole case to me. Trust in me. Believe in me. Don't be afraid. Only believe. And eventually, they get round to the vicinity of Jairus' house and they can hear them before they can see them. The professional mourners have arrived, and as is the custom in the East, they're weeping and they're wailing, and there's a great commotion, there's a great turmoil outside the house, and they're all surrounding the house and tearing their clothes and crying out and wailing. The Lord Jesus moves up to them and says, now, what's all the commotion for? She's only sleeping. Now you might ask, well, did the Lord not believe? Did she die? Some people think, well, she didn't die at all. The Lord Jesus said she was sleeping. I think it's quite clear that she did die. The girl did die. Because in another gospel, it tells us that when the Lord Jesus healed her, her spirit came again. But what the Lord is saying is this. What to you is death, to me is like a sleep. And she is capable of being wakened up. And of course, they ridicule him. They laugh him. The Bible says, another version says, they laughed him to scorn. And the Lord Jesus, calmly, he just dismisses them. He puts them all out. And now, did you count them when we were reading? There were three disciples. There was the mother and the father. That's five. There's the girl herself. That's six. And there's the Lord Jesus. That's seven. Seven's a very important number in the Bible. And the Lord Jesus puts them all out. And he enters into the what was the sick chamber, but is now the death chamber. And you can just imagine the scene. As this lifeless form of a 12-year-old girl lies on the bed. Now just watch what the Lord Jesus does. This is wonderful. You see, the Lord Jesus in the New Testament, in the Bible, it tells us that three times the Lord Jesus raised the dead. And when it was an older man called Lazarus, he just stood outside the grave and shouted his name, and Lazarus came out. Then we find it was maybe a younger man, a widow's son. He was being carried on a bier or a pallet or a coffin, you might say. He was being carried to his burial. And the Bible says the Lord Jesus came and he actually put his hand on the coffin. He stopped the procession. But when we come to this 12-year-old girl, the Lord does something very tender. He goes in and I think he sits down beside her and he takes her by the hand. He takes her by the hand. And then he says to her very gently, Talitha kumai. Talitha kumai. And of course, that's Aramaic. That's the language that people would talk, use in their everyday life. And the Bible gives us the interpretation. He's really just saying to her, young girl, rise up. Young girl, awake. Young girl, get up. And they tell us that this is the expression. There's more tenderness in it than our English translation maybe allows. But they tell us that this is the expression that her mother would use to waken her every morning. She would go into her room and perhaps she'd put her hand on her shoulder and she would shake her gently and she would say, Talitha kumai, Talitha kumai. And as the Lord Jesus speaks those words, they weren't magic words because people used them, other people used them. But when the Lord Jesus spoke with his authority, then something begins to happen in the realm of the dead. And the dead begins to respond, and her eyelids flutter, And her eyes open, and to their astonishment, and he's still holding her hand at this point, and she sits up in the bed, and then she swings her legs out of the bed, and the Bible says she gets up, and she walks around the room. One of the other versions I was looking at says that at this sight, those present almost lost their senses with joy. I think that conveys the absolute amazement and thrill and the wonder of it. Can you imagine the parents standing there, and here is the girl who has just died, and she has been brought back from the realm of the dead. And to prove it, she's not just opening her eyes and sitting up, she's walking around the room, and the Lord Jesus says, give her something to eat. What we don't read, but what did happen, was this: that Jairus did put this case into the hands of Christ. When the Lord Jesus said to him, don't be afraid, only believe, Jairus could have said, well, there's no point in you coming any further. There's no point in you coming any further. There's no point in taking this matter. I'll leave you to deal with other people. I'll go home and console my wife and deal with my grief. But Jairus put the matter into the hands of Christ. And when he did that, amazing things happened. You might say, well, that's an interesting story. That's a nice story. But what does it to do with me? Well, when we read, Paul writes to the Christians in Ephesus, and he says to them, you were dead. You were dead. Dead in your sins. As far as God was concerned, you were just like that lifeless girl lying on the bed. But Paul goes on to say, God, who is rich in mercy for his great love with which he loved us, he has made us alive in Christ. And how did that happen? Well, he goes on to say, by grace you were saved through believing, through trusting, through putting your salvation in the hands of Christ. Dear friends, that's a message tonight. Perhaps you're listening to this and you realize that I'm not right with God. I'm at a distance from God. It's a lot worse than you ever imagined. You are dead as far as God is concerned. We're dead in our sins. But the Lord Jesus can say to you, Talitha Kumai, he can speak the word. He can raise you from the spiritual death that you're in, because he died on the cross for your sins and he rose from the dead, and he's a living savior with power over death. And all he asks you to do is this: only believe. Put it in his hands. You can't do it. No one else can do it. No church can do it. But he can do it. Be not afraid. Only believe. We're going to close now in prayer. If you've never trusted Christ to be your savior, dear friends, this is something we all need to do. It's something we all need to do. We need to place the salvation of our souls in his hands and accept him and trust in him and believe in him. And you can do that now as we close in prayer. Let's pray. Father, we give thanks for our Savior, the Lord Jesus. What a wonderful Savior he is. How would Jairus and his family ever forget this meeting, this moment? How, when that girl walked down the street, people would turn and gaze at her and watch and say, that was the girl who once was dead and now she's alive. Our God, we give thanks that there is a Savior who can do what no other can do. We praise thee for his death on the cross. We thank thee he lives, and he is the Savior of all who trust in him. We pray that somebody on this call, perhaps tonight, may simply realize that only he can save because of his death on the cross. And we pray that somebody may simply believe on him and trust him to be the Savior tonight. We pray for thy blessing now in his precious name. Amen.